Hi students, I'm Sonia from Vidya Guru. We are starting a new session and this session is basically about sentence rearrangement. If you are not familiar with the term, let me make you familiar with the another term, and that is parajumbles, or you can call it jumbled up paragraph. There are sentences, multiple sentences which are given to you, but they are not given in the right order. You have to place them in the right order. That's what rearrangement is. Such kind of video is going to help you a lot in almost all the competitive exams. I should not say that it is going to help you in only bank exam or SSC exam. It is going to help you in every competitive exam. The session is important and relevant. If you cannot understand the entire thing, you can even rewatch the video. That is going to help you out. I'll try to relate it as much as possible. At the end, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to use grammatical terms just to make you familiar with how we relate one sentence with the other. If you like the video, you can press the like button, share the video with your friends so that they can get the benefit of such kind of video. And apart from that, I would suggest you do subscribe to our channel. If you do that, we upload a lot many videos which are exam relevant, and even they are going to help you out. Let me start from the very first sentence, and you have to be very focused. This is challenge one of rearrangement. If you understand, I've started this series, challenge series, by just telling you that challenge one is actually challenge. That series has the questions which are more difficult than other questions. The level of this question is even higher than other easy rearrangement questions. Let's start from it. Challenge one. I'm going to start this session right away. If you read the entire part, just take a hang of the entire passage first of all. See, you have to read the passage once so that you can be familiar with the passage. If you don't do that, because right now I'm going to take you to the answer straight away by relating one sentence with the other, there'll be a reason, and I'm going to tell you that reason as well. But when you start, you have to read the entire passage once just to be familiar with the idea. Let me tell you one thing. There's a starter here, and there are a few sentences. You have to rearrange all of them, but the starter is fixed. You cannot move this starter from here. So we'll start with the starter and then we'll move to the next sentence, which should come after this starter. Let's read that starter once. 25 centuries ago, when the Greek traveler Herodotus visited the already ancient monuments of Egypt, he found that the tourists had gotten there first. We are saying that there was a man, he was basically a traveler, and his name was Herodotus. I am going to narrate it like a story, and I feel that will actually make this passage easy. That will actually make the passage easy for you, easier for you. I am saying that there was a traveler by the name of Herodotus. He visited the ancient monuments of Egypt, and that too 25 centuries ago, but he visited, that means he thought that he must be the first one. But it is written something else here. It is something else. It is said that he found something else, that the tourists had gotten there first. That means the tourists had already visited the place, had already visited those monuments which he was visiting in the past time. Herodotus was a traveler. He visited the ancient monuments of Egypt, and he got to know that the tourists had gotten there already. Alright, if you got to know about the starter, let's move to the point which is going to come after that, and that is E. We'll start with E. I'll tell you the reason, all the relevant reasons. I'm going to highlight one word here, that's verb. What comes after this starter? That's E, the statement E. What is written here? Why am I placing it here? Their names were scratched on the crumbling ruins in hundreds of ancient languages. Whose names? Whose names are we referring to? Please understand that Herodotus got to know about the presence of those travelers, and there was a reason. He found out something there that could actually disclose that tourists had gotten there first. So what was the reason? What was the reason? How did Herodotus come to know about the presence of tourists there? You understand that? Tourists were there, but how did he come to know about that? He saw their names were scratched on the crumbling ruins in hundreds of ancient languages. Tourists had gotten there first and their names were scratched on the crumbling ruins. Crumbling ruins, that means we are referring to the buildings in the dilapidated state. If you don't understand the word, I can actually say that buildings which are not in the fine or sound state, in the bad state, which are about to fall, remains, or you can say the pieces, the state of the things which is bad. Crumbling ruins, we are referring to the buildings which are in very bad plight. Here we are referring to the kind of monuments or stones that they are basically crumbling ruins, on which tourists had gotten there first and they scratched their names in hundreds of ancient languages. Their names, whose name, tourist's name. You have to relate it like that. I'm going to move to the other sentence after E. I'll explain it. Don't worry. Let me finish first and then I'm going to use terms for it. E should be related with C. And there's a reason behind it. Generally, students say that, ma'am, why not C after the starter straight away? Why not C after the starter straight away? There's a reason, I'll explain that as well. Let me take that question. Tourists are still coming to Egypt and are probably still inscribing their names on old stones. Please understand that I've written C after E. The next thing which I'm going to tell you, why I'm relating E and C, let me highlight those words here. Their names here and tourists are still coming to Egypt, their names here as well. That means both these sentences have become mandatory pairs. Both these sentences have become mandatory pairs. And what sort of term is this, mandatory pairs? That means I'm referring to two sentences which have to be together. You cannot place any other sentence between them. Mandatory pairs. C and E are mandatory pairs because they have the same sort of words which we were actually looking for. That means one reason is that you, when you relate one sentence with the other, that means words can be the same. Here I've seen that their names, both the terms were used. All right, why not C after the starter straight away? Here it was the past tense. Had gotten there first, then I've actually touched the past tense in the flow. Had gotten there first, I cannot place after past, I cannot place R straight away. Present tense can't be there. As I've started with past, I got a clue that past tense is still there. So I've used that sentence, which is the continuation of the starter. So from past tense to past tense, and then I'm switching to the present tense. Now let me tell you what the context is. The context was, tourists had gotten there first. It is written here that their names were scratched on the crumbling ruins. They still come to Egypt and they still do the same thing that they write their names on. They inscribe their names on old stones. It is the case, it is the flow which I'm actually right now telling you. Had gotten there first, their names were scratched, had gotten, were scratched, past tense. If they come now, they do the same thing. So that's the relevance, past tense, and here it is the present tense. So tourists are still coming to Egypt. And why not C after the starter? There is one more reason, and that's still at two places here. Can you understand, when we write such a word like still, we all know that something happened in the past, something of this sort happened in the past, that is why we are using such a word still. Still is used that something of this sort was happened earlier. It says that tourists are still coming to Egypt and are probably still inscribing their names on old stones. That means still coming to Egypt, they write their names again. But we are saying that something of this sort happened in the past. That is why we are using such a word, that's still here. Let's move to the other point. What should come after C? Now we are going to use F here. What's the reason of using F here? Tourists are, they are. Tourists are, they are. Present, present, continuation. Apart from that, look for the other word. Tourists are probably, tourists are probably. So tourists are probably, they are probably. Tourists are probably, they are probably sharing another experience to standing in silent. Please understand, when tourists go to monuments, when tourists visit the monuments, they inscribe their names. That's one experience, that's the experience which they share. But this sentence says that they share something else as well. You know, besides writing their names, they are probably sharing another experience too. So what sort of experience did we talk about? That was that they write their name, they inscribe their names, and it is written here that they share another experience too. Two means also that means they have shared some other experience, and that was writing their names. Standing in silent and involuntary admiration before the great structures, and silently posing those inevitable questions why and how. Now they relate the things very easily. Now they say that, you know, the passage is easy. Because when I tell them that why is written here and you have to relate this why with this why, then they understand it that quickly. Now it becomes easier. I'll tell you. What is that? What is written here? I am standing in front of a gigantic structure. Gigantic structure which was actually made or developed or built by the Egyptians. I'm saying the people of Egypt have actually built that structure, that gigantic structure. I am standing silently without any movement. Involuntary has a different meaning here. Involuntary, where I'm not moving. Standing silently, not at all moving. The question is there in my mind. What sort of question is that? That's why. See, the question is about that gigantic structure only. The question is about that gigantic structure only. And that says why and how. Here is the answer in the B. Here is the answer in the B. So the next part should be F and B here. I was saying that when we are talking about this sentence, why, the question starts here and the answer is there in B. The why is easy. See, even F and B are mandatory pairs. F and B have become mandatory pairs because one is the question and the other one is the answer of that same question. The why is easy. Religious beliefs that sought perpetuation. Perpetuation, the word shows the meaning, the word has the meaning that shows permanence. Permanence. So perpetuation, something is forever. Perpetuation, something is forever. So religious beliefs that sought perpetuation in masses of stones so ponderous, they must be measured in tons and acres, and that demanded that these material manifestations of faith be not only huge but also permanent. We are referring to the religious beliefs of Egypt, the people of Egypt who have actually made the gigantic structures. They say that those material manifestations of faith, because they have actually generated those structures, we are saying those material manifestations, those gigantic structures should not be only huge. They should be permanent. Their religious beliefs should be permanent. Their religious beliefs should be permanent. They have created the gigantic huge structures for them. I am saying that those huge structures should not be only huge. They should be permanent. Those religious beliefs should be permanent. Continuing this same sentence, you have to underline this word, they both have the same sort of meaning. Here I'm going to relate B with the option D. And what is the continuation? What is the option of D? Why I'm using D after B? B is basically the idea. B is basically the idea. Idea. And example of this idea is given in D. That's the example of that idea. The same thing is being conveyed here in the option D with an example. In the words of Ramses II, who dedicated the magnificent temple of Medinet Habu in the 13th century BC, this was to be a palace of the god, lord of the gods forever. There's another word which actually relates B with D, and the word is forever. The word is forever. The continuation of B is in D. The continuation of B is in the D. Those gigantic structures, those huge structures, and the example of it is that magnificent temple. That huge structure, that magnificent temple, they are actually related, and D is the example of B. Then we are moving towards the last one, the last sentence, and that's A. At times students get confused and they say, ma'am, A should come after B, because even they have this sentence has the word eternity, which also means permanent. So four words are there: perpetuation, permanent, forever, and eternity. They almost mean the same. So people generally say that, you know, this should come first, but I need to tell you something. Just look at the sentence A and try to find out. This does not seem to be the sentence which comes in the middle of somewhere or some passage. This kind of sentence generally starts the passage, or this kind of sentence generally comes at the end. That actually gives you the clear idea. And B and D, they are related, because D is the example of B. That is why D comes after B, and after D, the last sentence is going to be A, that Egyptians build for eternity. Egyptians build for eternity. When they create these huge structures, they are built for forever, just to create permanence in the mind of people. Let me re-explain it very quickly by using the grammatical terms. Let me start it very quickly. I need to tell you, when you actually go through the passage first, look at the past tense, present tense, such things have to be checked first. I had checked it, that is why had gotten was related with were. That is why to, this is the grammatical term I'm using for you. So both these sentences got together, both these sentences got attached basically by just looking at the past tense. Then you have to check one more thing, that tourists and their names. Noun, pronoun. Pronoun comes after the noun. The same thing happened here as well. Tourists, that was the noun of the sentence, and one pronoun came after for the same thing. And where is the pronoun of the tourist? That was they. That was they. Here is the pronoun. So that was the union, that was the point to actually make them united, to bring them together. Tourist, noun, and noun is name, and pronoun which comes after the noun for the same noun which it was referring to. So tourist, they, noun, pronoun, that was the funda. Present tense had to be checked. Same kind of words generally relate the sentences. And what happened? Why did I relate? I told you that probably this was the word, probably this was the word. Both these words got united. Their names, these sentences became the mandatory pairs. So there can be many reasons, many things which can actually help you to look for the right answer, or to actually look for the right sentence. Permanent, perpetuation, eternity, and forever. This is actually going to give you some sort of idea that all the similar words were used and all these sentences are related with one another. So look for the same words, look for the same tense. Noun should come before the pronoun. That means pronoun should follow the noun. So such videos will be there in front of you. We are wrapping it up now. Thank you.